This is the Fifth Eye. You might think of it as a retirement home or a veterans hospital, but it wasn't always this way. Look around you. He gestures at the pipes and the disused machinery. There's a reason we're here. Ask your questions. Can you tell me about the nature of the Fifth Eye? What did you mean when you said it was a veterans hospital? He raps on the nearby wall. It's a solid sound, no vibration. We don't know what this place was, though the pipes and the machinery make it seem like a kind of pumping station. But what it is to us is, and then his mind whispers in yours, sanctuary. A crawling sensation like insects under your scalp. This is what the outside world is. You see an image of the city beneath you, writhing with ribbons of light that flare in a million colors. Each of these ribbons is a thought, word, deed, and each calls out for attention. His companions nod. He continues, speaking, "When we're here, we can dampen that noise. The voices become voluntary. We can still listen, but it's not insistent. Whatever else this building is, it's shielded, safe for our kind." It's an old machine, a remnant of some prior world, whose creators used it to deliver mysterious and sometimes potable fluids, and who shielded the interior somehow from psionic noise. Tell me about the history of the Fifth Eye. The psychically sensitive have been hiding here for generations. The endless battle, the cobalt breach, the rising blood, all the great psionic conflicts have victors and the defeated. But more importantly, they have the wounded, the veterans. The scars of a thousand mental battles slip away here. We can let our guards down. He drinks. And so we do. It's a long history. I should write it down sometime, but, he shrugs, I'm feeling lazy. It's generations old, at least as a bar. Much older than a machine of the ancient worlds, his mind whispers, and our kind have sought its sanctuary for years. If I can answer, I will. What can you tell me about the adversaries? A good question. Better if I show you. He closes his eyes, and you feel an insistent nudge in your mind. Then your vision goes black, replaced with a nightmare. You see a void, oblivion, a place where black stars hang and shriek with formless rage. Violet lightning arcs through the sky, and you witness enormous masses of pustulant orbs raging against each other. Streams of conscious thought rocket from them, and they scream of need, desire, hatred. Other emotions arise with these, wisps of mental energy that curl like steam. They brush your consciousness with a touch beslimed with the unknowable hungers of an alien mind. These luminous wisps quest through invisible cracks in dimensional walls. New worlds, unsuspecting minds, brilliant lights enfolded in the adversary's decaying orbits, imprisoned stars winking out forever. They came through the bloom, shining and tenebrous at the same time, he whispers. They offered games, riches, promises for the future. I felt their passage and was afraid, and I hid my mind from their questing touch. I felt them reach for me, and I cowered in my shell. Sayobi lays a hand on Dhamma's shoulder. Those who didn't hide saw the lure, and they were drawn into that unwinnable mental game, attracted by the light of the adversary's minds. They followed their own dreams into madness. Psychics and normal people alike. The ruin of the city's minds was... She shakes her head. You were wise enough to see beyond the lure and into the danger. You couldn't stand against them yourself, and so you hid. We all did. Not all, Therberus growls. Some stood. They played the game and got cracked like glow globes. I felt them die, and their spirits got sucked into a vortex of endless fear. You did the right thing, Dhamma, and I've told you that before. Fine, fine, Dhamma replies, waving the words away. But you've seen what the adversaries are like now. Inhuman and no negotiation. With no negotiation. Maybe they're communicating with us and we don't understand them. But I tell you, if this is their hello, I don't want anything else to do with them. So those of us who survived that initial incursion gathered here. We set aside our differences and we fought back, but not without our own losses. Totally alien, utterly horrifying, rapacious. His eyes are hard, and you feel the depths of his rage, and more powerful than you can imagine. Had more of their streamers soaked through, or snaked through, I don't know if we would have survived. He looks at his friends. As strong as we were, we took losses. That's why I will fight the adversaries wherever I find them, because we can't let even one remain. What are the adversaries? I don't know. What we see isn't the whole picture. We know that. It's an extrusion into our world, just a piece of the creature's psychic material. Maybe it's a conscious unit on its own. Maybe it's self-directed. Sorry, guys. But my deepest fear is that every adversary we've seen is the smallest piece of a singular entity, and that our pushback is drawing its attention ever so slowly towards us. He shivers. If you ever meet one, you'll know why that frightens me so. What if the sorrow is an adversary? What if the sorrow is that one adversary? Yeah, right? That's what he thinks is here. What I know? What I think I know? I know that each manifestation of an adversary is only a small part of a larger being. What I think I know, what I fear, is that only one adversary exists, and it's becoming aware of us. How do you fight the adversaries? Are you thinking you might use your labyrinth to trap it? Don't. Don't do it. He steeples his fingers under his shin and considers, though, wait, it might work. It might. He looks at Thurboros and Zayobi. They exchange a wordless communication, and he shrugs. We used a spotter, someone trained to recognize their scent. He'd give them the briefest engagement, enough to whet their appetites, and he'd bring them to a battlefield of our choosing. The adversary will tempt you with something. It will tap into the parts of your mind you had forgotten, ignite a desire. It will offer bargains, tastes of power, and try to draw you toward its way of thinking. The key is to keep control of the imagery and the metaphors your minds conjure together. That is where I come in. Thurboros leans forward on the table, his gaunt face seeming even more drawn. I'd feed words and stories to our spotter, help him build an internal story that seemed to mirror what the adversary told, and I'd lay a pathway toward our battlefield. He'd walk down that pathway, and the adversary would be extruding itself into our world right alongside him. His smile is hard and feral, and then we'd close off the exits and get to work cutting it to pieces. Dhama says, so, tell a story, resist the adversary's metaphors, build in the details of your hardened mental space, draw it in, and then use your familiarity with the place to destroy the bastard. He swallows the rest of his drink. If you're going to try, and again, I can't emphasize enough that you should seek our help, but if you do it alone, gods, I can't believe I'm saying this, if you do it alone, be careful. How do we fight them? As a team, with a trained spotter, a twister of a metaphor, a seer, a focus, and whatever else we can throw at it. We don't do it alone. He looks at the others. But if you plan to do it yourself, share the idea space with it, plant metaphors reminiscent of your labyrinth, turn the language that way. When you've got the tendril trapped, close your mind and use the terrain to your advantage. Can you tell me about the people here? He smiles, a little wistful. Sure, but keep in mind most of them can hear us. Who did you want to gasp about? The others burst out laughing. He gestures around the bar. They've all got their stories. Some of them aren't from this world. Some aren't even real. This summons another peal of laughter. He points his chin around the room. There's Thurboros, Zayobi, and Leto. Oh, and Ferioc. We own the place together. We've fought in all manner of wars, battles, and conflicts. We've traveled for some worn Esper helmets for others, or projected ourselves across the world. But the worst was the adversaries. They were the true test for all of us. They forged our friendship tighter than any experience could have. The bro says, best part is we've sacrificed our lives, our friends, and our sanity for a city that'll never know. They keep on with their daily lives and just assume the rash of madness is some effect of the Numenera. Gave up the best part of our minds, and they don't even care. Doesn't matter to me what the rabble think, but it'd be nice to get at least some professional recognition. Dhama says, we've been over this, Thurboros. We don't do it for ourselves. We do it because it's the right thing. What does it matter if they know or not? The important thing is that you took action. Red? That'd be gold. Sure, saving the lives of people who flinch when they see me coming. If I had chosen the other one, we would have gotten indigo for, or is that silver? It'll be silver for, recognition and, yeah, stuff. Saving the lives of people who flinch when they see me coming? I love seeing mothers snatch their children from my path. Clearing the insects from my bedroll is the next important step, and knowing that I took action, because the ingrates in Sega's Cliffs won't even sell me a damn clean sheet. If they were dead, at least I could steal their sheets. Dhama says, who do you think the adversaries would go after once all the citizens were dead, friend? You think they'd head out into the world, leaving your mind glowing bright behind them? I could shield myself, no problem. I did it when they came out, remember? Just like you. Yes, I did. But I found help, and we hunted those bastards down and wiped most of them out. You, if you were alone here, you'd get tired of having to hide your true self around them and start cursing at them just so they'd notice you. Thebros turns and holds his hands up. You see what I have to put up with? I ask for a modicum of respect, and instead I get mockery. I don't know why we pay attention to this old gallows glass. How did you all come to this place? Dhama frowns. It called to us. It was a beacon. It was warm and welcoming. The first time I set foot inside these doors, the noise from the outside world lessened. It didn't disappear. I can focus and hear it as I wish, but I could let my guard down. Relax. He looks around the room. I'd wager the same is true of all the others. I came from the bloom, as my name suggests, and when I needed a place to rest my mind, I saw this place glowing bright. Let's talk about Thebaros. Despite his terrible complexion, gaunt face, bird-like nose, and questionable taste in haberdashery, actually I'm trying to think of any redeeming qualities that might offset on any of this. Thebaros says, I'm right here, you know. He ignores his friend. Yes, despite all these obvious disadvantages, Thebaros has become one of the preeminent warriors of language in the entire world. You can laugh, but the old saying is undeniably true. The tongue with the word is deadlier than the hand with the sword. Unless the sword hand gets to you before you can make someone else get in the way, Thebaros mutters. Dhama laughs. He can plant words in your mind that will activate and weaponize your body against itself. With a word, he can spin illusions inside your skull. He knows the hidden receptors and compartments of the mind, and he can whisper lock you dead. Whisper lock? That's a fair enough assessment, eh? His friend nods. This time they disappear, instead of reappearing and saying, I don't have anything to say about this person. I already told you, or whatever. Let's talk about Ziobi. Ziobi says, let's not. Nonsense, Dhama says. Ziobi is our enforcer, our telekinetic. She summons visions for us to distract our foes, projects deadly energy, and harnesses the power of the physical world to anchor us or our enemies while we deliver the killing blow. She also lets us focus our energy through her. She is what you might call our heavy weaponry, because she makes the immaterial world much, much more tangible. While we frolic in the playgrounds of the mind, she's concerned with more earthly matters. How poetic, you old Skylark. Truly you took the word straight from my... Why, you dirty thief! Dhama holds up his hands in surrender. You are practically shouting, Ziobi. How could I help but listen? Let's talk about Leto. She's our seer, our prescient. She knew where the adversaries were going to be. She knew when they'd be here, so we could set ourselves up in time. His voice is somber, but they grew wise to her. They threw themselves through probability space, played the game of maybe with her, and they were better than she was. Not so loud, Thebaros murmurs. It wasn't her fault. I never said it was. He radiates tension. The adversaries got better than all of us. We're lucky they only... He wipes a tear from his eye. We're lucky we only took the losses we did. Let's talk about Ferioc. The smile slips from Ziobi's face, but she says nothing. Dhama doesn't look toward the bar, but his mood turns somber. A true empath, our spotter, back when he could do the work. A brave man, aware of the risks he took. Psychically sensitive, able to catch the lure of the adversaries, and willing to run with it. If it hadn't been for him, we'd never had the success we did. He looks down at the table. The last one we fought caught him. It took his... He pauses, lost in thought. Zayobi steps in. It took some of the things that made him special. He can't spot for us anymore. His powers aren't what they were. He's a shadow of his own self, of his old self. Let me guess. He died or something like that. And he's the projection. They're projecting... Well, she is actually the projector, she said. She's projecting him, but of course he can't be as he fully was because he's powered by her mind. He's not actually his own being under his own power. So that's why I think he is the projection. Deborah says, but the old skiss sucker has our thanks anyway. He raises his glass toward the bartender and drops it on the table as Zayobi punches his arm. Ow! It's bad luck, you know. Don't you speak an ill word about him, Theberos. Not after what he did. You know how I feel about Ferioc, Zayobi. He swishes the liquid left in his glass, his head and voice lowered. Before he lost his powers, he was one of the best of our team. One of the best I've ever known. They all nod. He cackles. But don't tell him I said so. Zayobi punches him again. Let me ask about something else. Zayobi challenged me to find out which of you is a projection, so are you real? Me? I'm as real as they come. He slaps his belly. Could a projection do that? He pauses. Come to think of it, Zayobi probably could make one do that and make it sound right, too. She's good. But how would you test whether a psychic emanation was real? Touch him. Otheboros? He doesn't move and your finger sinks into his flesh. He grins. Satisfied? Zayobi said I should focus on physicality. Here's a hint. He reaches out and claps you on the shoulder, his fingers holding tight. Projections play on your expectations, but they're pierced easily. He leans back. Good luck with it. Theberos said I should pay attention to your stories. I hate to say it, but he's right. For once. What do the others say about me? Do I even have any interesting stories? Anything about growth, journey, change? I'm not sure I do have any good stories. I'm the same as I've always been. Theberos says sadly, more's the pity. Leto said I must know how reality must behave. Good advice. Am I behaving differently than others suggest I should in reality? Ferioc said I should know my subjects. And if you knew me, then you'd know there's nothing incongruous about how I'm behaving now. Not gonna do this yet, or that. A pleasure. I'm gonna tell her. It's the bartender, Ferioc. Oh god. Pathing. Can you tell me about the adversaries? Didn't she say? I didn't ask her that before. I don't know where they came from, or what they want, or any of that. Her voice is becoming harsher, more distorted with suppressed anger. I only know that they destroy everything they touch and that I will destroy them. My friends pull their extrusions into the real world, and then I get to sever them from their source. She downs her drink. I love doing that. Sorry, I'm the heavy hitter. My friends point me at the problem, and I take care of it. I know who the psychic projection is. She laughs and crosses her arms. Who? I think it's Ferioc. She laughs delightedly. I won't even ask how you figured that out. If you guessed, it was a lucky guess, but your instincts were right. But then her face falls. No, I didn't guess. I wasn't completely sure, but he seemed the most likely one. I began manifesting him after he was killed. Knew it. Well, mostly. He was our spotter, the man who saw the adversaries and lured them to our battleground. But the last adversary we fought, it was ready for us. It called caught hold of the lure he offered, and it followed his mind all the way to reality. It burned. She pauses, chokes back a sob. It burned him from the inside. She looks into the distance. He lured it to us, and with his dying will, nailed it into place. Dhama says it was a sacrifice any of us would have made, Zayobi, no matter who was in that position. He speaks softly, as if trying to convince himself. Zayobi continues, The adversary didn't pay attention to us, even as we poured our heaviest attacks into it. I was too absorbed in destroying Ferioc, tearing him apart instead of defending itself. It was too absorbed in destroying Ferioc, tearing him apart instead of defending itself, as if its first priority was in blinding us instead of preserving itself. Her voice turns hard. We beat it, though. So long as I'm breathing, I'll keep his memory alive. He'll serve his drinks and make his bad jokes, and everyone here will feel welcome. It's the least I can do in his name. Oh. Alright, Dhama, let's ask him about Clarion. Oh, wait, you know what? What if he knows he's a projection? I'm not gonna tell him that, but just wonder if the option's there. That's me.
Absolutely.
Oh god, I'm stuck.
It is done.
Malaise. I want to talk to Malaise.
Find him. Something to do.
Yeah, talk to people. Dhama said you're blind. What does that mean? He laughs. I used to be the spotter for this gang. Means I could sense the presence of the adversaries. Build an attractive playground for him and drawing them after me. The last one I faced, though. His face falls, and it draws into himself. It burned me out. It put out my eyes. It burned me out. It put out my... And then he is back to normal, smiling as if nothing had happened. Huh. Oh, that's spooky.
Action! Here I come!
Yeah, except you just don't move. Malaise? This small, unassuming man occupies this space quietly, hands folded in front of him. He does not look at you, but you can feel his regard slip across you and dismiss you as you approach. His attention remains focused on the trio at the nearby table. Everything about him is nondescript, from his light brown skin to his drab clothing, but something about him gives you pause, as if you were approaching the throbbing core of a fallen vessel. Well, he looks pretty descript to me. When at last he turns his attention on you, you feel his regard settle, like a soft blanket made of metal. It is almost oppressive. Malaise, he says. That is who I am. His voice sounds distorted, strangely out of sync, as if he were calling to you from a distance. You can't read his thoughts anymore, but you can read the thoughts of the tables at the bar. Really? Where did you come from? His voice is strange and disjointed. The world has always known me. Look around the corner. I exist on the smallest edge. Close your eyes and shiver. I am the cold in your bones. The cicade is my home. The interstice is my mind. The frost that surrounds his words suggests that you have offended him. Can you tell me about yourself? I am a constant. I live. I thrive. When a thought passes in your mind, I rush before it. I hear the pulsing of your thoughts. I am fabric, essential. Can you tell me anything more? A wave of annoyance pulses from him. No. Why are you watching these people? They shine. They call. They tempt. His voice shimmers strangely, and you hear a distorted echo of thousands of voices mimicking his words. The illusion of time surrounds them. Death has coiled. Probabilities collapse and shiver until inevitability crushes them. Unawareness is intoxicating. What can you tell me about this place? He slowly turns his gaze toward the other patrons. A lodestone. A gathering of energies. Empty meat. A brief morsel. An obstruction. A bone. An ingrown hair. His empty, terrifying gaze turns back to you. An impediment. The taste of failure and regret, fresh minds and stale hearts, a bitter loss in friends. His eyes fix you to the spot. Negation in service. A tragedy that awaits. Okay. So you think their future is not so bright, I guess. Do you know your name means sickness? Meaning itself is sickness. Vision, action, movement. This is the only sign of health. His slow and indolent gaze is like a great weight on you. The energy that flows in your body. I read it through your skin. I see your actions before your muscles even begin to twitch. The body's secrets are no defense against me. What is sickness compared to this? Is this the adversary? Or is the sorrow the adversary? There is no way to fare. I think I have a lead on the identity of the adversary. I am grateful for your help, friend. Tell me of your suspicions, and I'll see if I can confirm or allay them for you. Do you see that man there? Malaise? He's watching you. The blood drains from his face. What? Right there. I see nothing? I feel nothing. He grasps your mind with his, not gently, and he echoes in your skull. Anything that there is hidden to me. Ziobi, can you sense anything? Let me see, she says. In the center of her forehead, her skin irises open, and a third metallic eye protrudes from her, glowing brightly. It extends from her head on a mechanical segment, emitting a series of rapid flashes that descend through the visible spectrum. At last the eye retracts and her forehead closes. She swallows and you can feel the fear radiate from her. She's right. It's there, on a low pulse, a wavelength far below human thought.
Making a note.
A control as hard as synth steel surrounds him, Dhama says. The adversaries have never done this. I knew they adapted, but... By the Black Three, what has it learned? It has been watching us. But for how long? Ziobi, be ready. Let's confront it together, right now. Yes, we will. He swallows and whispers. We're not ready. We'll never be ready. He closes his eyes, and when he opens them again, they glow. But we can die trying. So gold and indigo raise a tiny amount. We're gonna fight now? I haven't fought yet. Hold! No one move. I know you're eager to get it over with, and that you're terrified. Don't think you can hide that, Ziobi. It's not necessary. We're all frightened. Here. Feel. A wave of his fear crashes over you, and your body reacts instinctively, releasing adrenaline. Under the fear is a will of iron, an adamantine determination, and a calm acceptance of whatever comes. All right. Motivation talk. We can do this, but we need to work together. Remember our training, and improvise as necessary. Now, let me prepare the killing floor. He closes his eyes, and you can feel reality rippling around you. His strength is undeniable, his mastery certain. Ready in three. As the world crumbles around you, a new vision takes its place. Two. You feel the push and pull of titanic minds struggling to establish the rules of this shared dream space. One. And then you sense Dhamma's control. Slip for just a moment, and the adversary gains the upper hand. Ah, Skist! Attack! Attack now! Hello?